So the best answer here is B, tuberous sclerosis. This is another classic board exam question. Now let's look at some of the features that makes choice B the best answer here. First of all, you see multiple lesions that's bright on T2 that affects the cortex and adjacent subcortical white matter. They tend to be patchy, they tend to be bilateral but asymmetric, and usually they are hypo-intense on T1 weighted sequence. Those are referred to as cortical or subcortical tubers. In addition, you see some multiple subependymal nodules that protrude into the ventricle. In this case, there's one of them that's adjacent to the foramen Monroe. And on SWR, you can also see there are multiple other lesions in a higher location. As you can see, many of them do calcify, so they are hypo-intense on SWI, and they will stand out on CT. This one right here, it enhances. Just because a subependymal nodule enhances, that in itself does not qualify as subependymal giant cell astrocytoma. You need to be at the classic location. Now I put a parenthesis here because this one does not qualify as subependymal giant cell astrocytoma or SECA because it's too small. To make the diagnosis of SECA, you need to see a couple of things. First, it's usually adjacent to foramen Monroe or right at the foramen Monroe, such as in this case and in this case. And also it need to be greater than 1 centimeter or 1.3 centimeter, depending on which textbook you read. Enhancement itself does not qualify as SECA. Now, if I see this lesion, for example, that continued to grow year after year after year, even if it's below 1 centimeter, my index suspicion will go up is that this is transforming into SECA. Here you have an example of a 12-year-old female with tuberous sclerosis, and it measures 1.4 centimeters. So location fits, size fits, so this is SECA. So year two, it becomes 1.7 centimeters, so it also grows. And at year three, it becomes 2 centimeters and developed a cystic changes, and that caused obstruction. So the surgeon went in and took it out, and histology is expected it is SECA. On the other hand, other subependymal nodules, they are expected to be static, so they should not grow year after year. So SECA, as you know, is a WHO1, so low-grade tumor, and it occurs almost exclusively in tuberous sclerosis patients. On the other hand, not all tuberous sclerosis patients, only about 20% of the tuberous sclerosis patients would have SECA. Other thing that they can ask you about tuberous sclerosis on board exam is a phycomatosis, and it's neurocutaneous syndrome, which affects the structure that derives from ectoderm. So things like CNS and skin, remember they come from the same lineage, neuroectoderm and ectoderm, and also eyes. So some of the common stuff that they love to ask you on board exam would be common phycomatosis, such as neurofibromatosis 1 and F2, tuberous sclerosis, like this case, Sturge-Weber, and Van Hippel-Lindau. The reason that they love to ask you on board exam for phycomatosis is that because they can ask you many different systems. So if they show you a case that involving the CNS, as well as other organs like kidney, liver, start to think about phycomatosis. For tuberous sclerosis, they can show you an example of renal lesion, so renal angiomyolipoma. They can show you a cardiac lesion, skin lesion, that's hypopigmented macule, the so-called ash leaf spot. Let's look at other answers that do not work as well in this case. Choice A, ADEM. ADEM, as you know, is the post-viral demyelinating syndrome. And I suppose some of the lesions can resemble cortical or subcortical tuber, and they tend to be patchy, and they are usually bilateral but asymmetric. And often they can involve in the deep gray structures, such as basal ganglia or thalamus, and that would differentiate this from, say, multiple sclerosis. And for the core lesion, the core involvement tend to be long segmented, so greater than 2 vertebral body segments, and they present as a transverse myelitis involving a large cross-sectional central part of the spinal cord, unlike again, multiple sclerosis tend to be short segmented and peripheral. And for ADEM, of course, you should not see subependymal nodule like tuberous sclerosis. Now with MS, kids can get MS too. This is an example of a 14-year-old with a MS. The lesion sometimes can resemble or look identical to ADEM. It's hard to distinguish. Again, multiple sclerosis, you should not see subependymal nodule like tuberous sclerosis. But as a generalization, when you study for board exam, there are some of the key features that can distinguish MS from ADEM. For example, involvement of the deep gray matter, involvement of corpus callosum, T1 black hole, or the appearance on the spinal cord. So if I see a lesion that involving deep gray matter, such as basal ganglia or thalamus, as generalization, I would pick ADEM. If I see involvement with corpus callosum, especially the undersurface of corpus callosum, as a generalization, I will pick MS over ADEM. If I see a lot of T1 hypointensity, that's MS. For the spinal cord lesion, ADEM is a long segment transverse myelitis, whereas MS lesions that tend to be short segmented, less than 2 vertebral body segments, and they tend to be peripheral or wedge shape. So those are the generalization between ADEM and MS. NF1, that's another phycomatosis that they like to ask you on board exam. They have multiple lesions, and some of them may look like a cortical or subcortical tuber, but the classic location for the fascia or the focal area of signal intensity, some people refer to this as NF dysplasia, go by different names. They tend to cluster around the deep gray matter, such as basal ganglia, thalami. They tend to present in the medial temporal lobe, hippocampus, or in the medial part of the cerebellar hemisphere, such as dentate nuclei. And they are vascularization of the myelin, so they are not neoplastic, even though they can show you NF lesion with other low-grade glioma, such as optic glioma or pilocytic astrocytoma. Other classic feature they can show you on board exam is moya-moya, or other type of bony dysplasia, such as sphenoid wing dysplasia or spinal dysplasia. For NF2, they can ask you about Miss Me syndrome, which stands for multiple inherited, S stands for schwannoma. So in this case, you have bilateral vestibular schwannoma. M stands for multiple meningioma. Here you have a classic example of meningioma that's involving the posterior part of the fox, invasion of the torcula, and another lesion that is intraventricular meningioma. Notice the homogeneous enhancement. Multiple spinal lesion E stands for ependymoma. If they show you multiple intramedullary lesion, that is ependymoma for NF2. Notice there's another lesion that's intradural but extramedullary. For my top two differential diagnosis of intradural extramedullary for any patient is either going to be schwannoma or nerve sheath tumor versus meningioma. And in this case, it could be either or. I would pick schwannoma. That's all for this tuberous sclerosis case. Thanks, guys, for your attention. Good luck on your board exam.